Report card 9 is about measuring how far behind children are allowed to fall. It looks at three areas of children's well-being: their material well-being, their health, and their educational well-being. And for each of 24 countries, it measures how far behind the norm for their society the most vulnerable children, the weakest children, are being allowed to fall. Obviously, you'll always have children who fall below the average. You'll always have children who fall into the bottom 10% in any area of life and in any society. But the critical question is, how far behind are those children allowed to fall? And how far behind is too far behind? At what point does that kind of inequality become not inevitable, but just unacceptable? What point does it become not inequality, but inequity? And that's a much more difficult question. And there are no widely agreed theoretical answers. What we try to do is provide the beginnings of a practical answer by measuring and comparing across 24 countries to see how far behind each country is allowing its more vulnerable children to fall. And we find that there is great variety in the answer. This is the first time that this issue has been measured in this way. And we find that there are a small group of countries, for example, Finland, Denmark, the Netherlands, Switzerland, who are doing a very much better job than the rest at preventing large numbers of their more vulnerable children, their at-risk children, from falling too far behind the norms of their society in health and education and material well-being. They're doing a much better job, for example, than the countries at the bottom of our league table, such as Greece, Italy, Spain, the United Kingdom, the United States. We thought it was important to look at well-being in the round. That's why we've chosen, we're limited by what data are available, but that's why we've chosen health, education and material well-being to try and present a more rounded picture than, say, poverty rates alone on child well-being. And we're hoping to focus, to use statistics to focus attention on the question of child well-being and on the fact that child well-being, which has such powerful implications for the future well-being of any society, is a very variable thing, and some countries are doing much better for their children than others, and that this will have very profound long-term consequences. And of course, at the back of our mind too, as at the back of everybody's mind, is that we're in tough economic times. And we know, and from UNICEF's long experience of this in the developing world, that in tough economic times, when economies turn down, unless specific action is taken to prevent it, what always happens is that it's the poorest children in the poorest families who bear the heaviest burden in times of economic downturn. And so we want to focus attention on protecting child well-being, and particularly of those children who are vulnerable to falling behind. And we believe there's a strong case in principle for this, because being poor or being at the bottom of the pile in any sense clearly isn't the child's fault. A child doesn't choose his or her circumstances. Yet at the same time, a child only has one chance to grow and develop normally in mind and body. And if that chance goes, that's it. There are lifelong consequences. And therefore, it's a primary responsibility of government, just as it is of society and of families, to protect that one chance that the child has to grow and develop normally in good times or in bad times. Now, that one chance to grow and develop and fulfill one's potential shouldn't depend upon growth rates of the economy or on interest rates or inflation rates or downturns in this or that economic indicator. It's their only chance, and it's a primary responsibility of us all at different levels to try and protect it. And that's what fundamentally this report is about. Across society as a whole, allowing children to fall too far behind has very serious consequences in a number of areas. It very significantly increases the probability of poorer cognitive development, of lower educational achievement, of lower skills and aspirations, leading obviously to lower productivity, lower incomes in adult life, higher risk of unemployment, of welfare dependence, statistically no question, a higher risk of involvement with the police and the law courts, higher risk of alcohol and drug dependence, very serious consequences with a very large price to be paid, not only by the individual child who bears the heaviest cost of all this, but a very big price to be paid by society, by economies, by businesses in lower productivity, in lower skills, in higher social welfare payments, in lost tax revenues, in lower returns on investment and education. This presents a very serious bill to society over the long term. And I think there is enough evidence from hundreds of studies in so many developed countries in the last 10 years especially, to show that societies that neglect this question of children falling behind, allowing children to fall too far behind the norms of their society, will pay a very large price for it. The report argues that wide inequality in children's well-being is not inevitable. It's policy susceptible. And our proof of this, our argument for this, is to measure how far children are falling behind in different societies, and to show that with roughly the same level of economic resources and facing very similar challenges, some countries are much more successful in stopping their children, their more vulnerable children, from falling behind the norms of their societies than other countries. So countries like Denmark, Finland, the Netherlands, Switzerland, the countries at the top of our league table, are doing very well in preventing their more vulnerable children from falling too far behind their norms of health and education and material well-being. The countries at the bottom of our new league table, including the United Kingdom, Spain, Italy, Greece, the United States, are allowing their more vulnerable children to fall a very long way behind the norms of their societies in these critical areas of child well-being. The point here is this is a measurable demonstration that a very large degree of inequality, of falling behind, isn't inevitable. It can't be inevitable if a group of countries on a national scale and with no more resources than the rest of the developed world are able to prevent it. So I think it's important to stress that we're not setting out here some kind of airy-fairy abstract ideal of equality and that all countries are being expected to live up to in some imagined paradise. We're setting a standard, and that sets a challenge because many countries are well below the standard, but the standard is based on what a significant group of countries have already achieved in practice. That's the power of that standard. It has been achieved, it is realistic. There is no good reason why all industrialized countries should not be able to achieve the same. That's the challenge the report sets out.